สวัสดีครับนักเรียนก็ขอโทษด้วยนะครับถ้าอัพช้านะครับเดี๋ยวผมจะซีเรียสแล้วนะครับเพราะว่าที่ผ่านมา productivity ต่ำแต่ตอนนี้รู้สึกผิดแล้วครับนักเรียนขอโทษด้วยนะครับเดี๋ยวจะรีบอัดให้แล้วก็จะได้ไม่แน่เราอาจจะสอบหลังหมายถึงว่าหลังตารางหน่อยนะครับผมอาจจะให้เวลาพวกคุณอาทิตย์นึงพิเศษเดี๋ยวผมกำลังดูอยู่ว่าจะทำได้หรือเปล่าส่วนเรื่องการสอบเนี่ยขอย้ำคิดค่อนข้างละผมส่วนตัวเลยนะส่วนตัวน่าจะประมาณว่าเราจะเป็นตอบคำถามนะมีประชุมทางซูมก็รายบุคคลนะนักเรียนรายคนแน่นอนนะครับแล้วก็ตอบคำถามเป็นคำถามความเข้าใจนะครับคำนวณเนี่ยไม่น่าจะมีแต่ว่าเวลาถามเนี่ยนะเวลาจะถามในการสอบก็จะถามว่าเจอเคสแบบนี้ต้องทำยังไงจะซบจะแก้ต้องซบยังไงนะเพราะงั้นสิ่งที่พวกเราต้องทำแน่นอนเหมือนเดิมแบบฝึกหัดต้องให้เข้าใจด้วยว่าทำแล้ว เป็นยังไงนะทำไมต้องทำแบบนี้ประมาณนั้นนะครับโอเคก่อนที่จะเริ่มเนี่ยนักเรียนก่อนที่จะเริ่มท็อปิกอันนี้นะครับก็จะขอพูดถึงเรื่องที่พูดหมายถึงว่าดิสคัสเมื่อมีตติ้งคราวที่แล้วนะออนไลน์มีตติ้งคราวที่แล้วก็นักเรียนทีนี้เนี่ยไอ้ถ้าใครที่ไม่คิดว่าไม่มีปัญหาอะไรหรือว่าไม่มีปัญหาอะไรเลยก็แล้วก็จะพูดเรื่องไอ้ข้อนี้ด้วยนิดนึงนะจะพูดเรื่องบล็อกจะขอกลับไปท็อปิก9พาร์ท1หน่อยถ้าใครคิดว่าทุกอย่างมีสบายใจพวกคุณฟาสต์ฟอร์เวิร์ดไปได้เลยนะรอไปล่วงหน้าเลยนะครับแล้วก็ไปฟังไอ้ตรงนี้เลยก็ได้อ่ะโอเค everyone so I want toThis is what we discussed in the class online meeting last time, okay? And one problem, let's say it's a warning from me, okay? It's a warning from me about how to solve the profit maximization problem. Usually, I sure you, all of you know that to solve for profit maximization, we set MC equal MR, right?And I want to make sure that you know that MR, everyone, MR and MC is the function of quantity. Of course, it is calculated by derivative of total revenue with respect to quantity, right? That's MR, and this is for MC. And everyone, you can see that the total revenue is a function of quantity as well. Total cost as well, okay? They are a function of quantity.But the difficult thing, everyone, the difficult thing is that sometimes you will be given this demand function, okay? This is called demand function. Demand function is the quantity as a function of price, all right? We call demand function quantity as a function of price. And someone may do it this way. Now you know that you have to find total revenue, right? You have to find the total revenue with respect to quantity. You know that total revenue is price multiplied with quantity. And by habit, let's say, by habit, you may do something like this. You may just substitute the Q directly into this one. Everyone, this is wrong, okay? You cannot do this. You must not do this. Why?Because if you do this, you see that what you get is 10p minus 2p squared. This is, and everyone, you cannot find the derivative, right? You cannot find derivative with respect to q. Actually, you can. But I mean, you have to substitute this p with this one first. You have to kind ofrevert this and then substitute back, but it will waste your time a lot. So everyone, don't do this. Make sure that not to do this. Okay. So, what can you do? What you have to do is okay. Let me write again. So your Q will be this one, right? Q equal to 10 minus 2p. What you should do is you should.Make this in this is called the demand function. You should make this into the inverse demand first. So how to do it? Just make make p a subject everyone make p a subject and then you get 5 minus 1 over 2 q this is what we call inverse demand so when you get this everyone when you get this you can easily find mr I told you many times already that mr is twice as steep as your inverse demand so mr will be 5 minus q that's it now you get mc then you will get the q star profit maximizing quantity here this is how you easily solve for this thing here so before we go continue with our price discrimination I want to go back to block tariff a little bit everyone so let me quickly go through what we did last time okay we did not do anything wrong but I think I should explain to you another way the actual way to solve for this to solve for question B here everyone because to put it simply everyone when we solve question A and B we use the midpoint rule all right we use the midpoint rule let's go back a little bit here so for question A I have this inverse demand and I have marginal cost so what I do is I use the midpoint rule and I simply get this 40 and 60 right actually what I can do is I can find mr right I can find mr okay maybe I can quickly solve it for you here so if my mr will be equal to 70 minus q right yeah and you can see everyone that I equate mr equal mc mc equal mr what I get is 60 as well okay so it's the same you can use midpoint rule or you can use mc equal mr that's up to you all right but for question B here for question B everyone is linked to question A all right question B and A are linked this is not but for question C is different okay question C is different but A and B are linked and for question B we say that let's suppose we use the price that we set in part A here which is 40 and 60 for the first block so what I did what we did is that we our first block we sell at the price of 40 we sell 60 unit and then after that I told we use the midpoint rule right and when we get 25 and 90 here that's how we do question that's how we did question B here everyone but this is kind of a simplified way all right but last semester someone asked me how we can solve this for let's say a hard way okay an actual way to solve for this problem and so let's call this question B star here how so everyone before we begin I want to explain to you that you can see that we have two part of the demand curve you have the fulfilled demand everyone fulfilled demand is this let's imagine that we have many people waiting to buy the good this is what demand is right many people waiting to buy the good someone who is there is someone who is willing to pay a lot and there is someone who is less willing to pay for the good so when the price is 40 everyone when the price is 40 someone who has high willingness to pay get to buy the good okay someone who value the good more than 40 baht or whatever will buy the good and we say that there are 60 people for example there are 60 people who get to buy actually in this case it's 60 unit but everyone for those who has low willingness to pay they will not buy the good right because the price is 40 they value the good lower than 40 so they don't buy the good and we call this residual demand curve so this zone here is the residual demand And actually, everyone to solve for this question B in an actual way, as I said, we have to kind of find the equation for residual demand. All right, we have to find equation for residual demand. And actually, if you, what I want you to imagine is that we kind of let's say that we have two parts, right? As I said, this part here, this demand here is already fulfilled. So what you can do is you can just kind of exclude this area. You can just exclude this area, right? And then you can try to find everyone. You can try to find the equation to describe this small curve here, small demand here. And you can see that this small curve here, the intercept on the y-axis, the y-intercept is 40. So that's why I put 40 here, everyone. And the slope, everyone, the slope part is the same, right? Because the slope part is, we say that the slope is minus 1 over 2 for this line. So actually it has to, 1 over 2 for the whole actual the market demand curve. So in this case, the slope here must be the same. All right. The only difference is the intercept, which will be 40 here because we exclude this part. Okay, we exclude this part, so it will be 40 here. And now I have this residual demand, right? Let's say that this is rest demand. Actually, it's residual inverse demand, right? Residual inverse demand. P equal to 40 minus 1 over 2 Q. Your MR will be 40 minus Q, and your MC is 10, everyone, MC is 10. So when you equate MC equal MR, what you get is Q star equal to 30, right? And your P star will equal to, you substitute this back into your residual demand curve, you get 25. So everyone, so this is the same conclusion that we get as what we did last time. Look carefully, okay? Look carefully. We say, when we did question B with the second block here, the second block, we sell at the price of 25. All right, we sell at the price of 25 for 30 more units, all right? For 30 more units. Yeah. Okay, this second block, 30 units here at the price of 25 here. The same, all right, the same. Actually, there is another way. Someone may still disagree with me. Oh, teacher, how can we simply know that this is the equation for residual demand? Everyone, the actual way to calculate residual demand. Now I'm going to call this QD. Okay. Now this will be different from this one. Okay. This is the residual inverse demand. Okay? Inverse demand, to be specific. Now I'm going to actually find the residual demand. Sorry, let's use the R here, QR. It will be equal to the market demand, all right? Market demand minus the fulfilled demand, all right? So the market demand, everyone, QD, the market demand is actually this one here, this equation here. But I have to, this is inverse, right? This is inverse demand. So what I have to do is, let's maybe I should write this down first. So this is P equal to 70 minus 1 over 2 Q, right? If I'm going to, this is inverse demand. Now I'm going to convert into the market demand. So it will be QD equal to 140 minus P. Okay, 140-p. Now that will go here. This is QD, right? This is QD. And everyone, don't forget that your fulfilled demand. Your fulfilled demand is the demand that has been fulfilled. So it's 60, right? The quantity that has already been fulfilled is 60. So your this QF will equal to 60, everyone. And equal to QR. That's your residual demand. And if you solve for this, everyone, if you solve for this one here, your residual demand will equal to 80 minus... I just realized that I did something wrong here. So what you have to do, this is 2P, everyone. This is 2P. Okay? So this one, you see that I cross multiply and you get 2P. And here it should be 2P as well. Sorry, let's do the rest. So this is 2P. And if when and what you can do is you can make it into the inverse demand, right? And you will see that P equal to 40 minus 1 over 2Q. Everyone, this is the same thing, right? This is the same thing as this one that I solved previously. Okay, so there are many ways. What I want to say is there are many ways to find the residual demand. You can have you can find it this way. All right, actually we are going to use this way afterward, so make sure to kind of familiarize yourself with this approach here. All right, Q residual demand equal to market demand minus the fulfilled demand. So your market demand is this one, and you already sold 60 units. This is the fulfilled demand, all right? 60 units. What is left is this one, and you make it into the inverse demand, inverse residual demand, and that's what you get, the same thing. Everyone, now let's go back to our price discrimination. I guess I mentioned everything I should, right? Yes. So, yes, I mentioned everything I should. So let's now continue to our topic here. So just to summarize, you see that for the first degree, we need the willingness to pay. For the second degree, we know that along the demand curve, there are someone who is willing to pay a lot. There are someone who is less willing to pay. And we are going to charge different price for different group for the second degree. Okay. But in this case, everyone, in this case, we cannot distinguish between group. All right. We cannot distinguish between group. That's why we still have this one demand curve. You cannot distinguish people or consumer among the demand curve. You only know that, yeah, there's some people who want to buy, who is willing to pay a lot, and there's someone who is willing to pay less. That's what you know for the second degree. But for the third degree, we can differentiate people. You can discern consumer in, you can categorize consumer into group. So for the third degree, you will have two demand. You will have two demand curve, and because you can group customer, right? You can group customer, and you charge different price for different group. And we actually, so let's continue. We cover all of this already, right? So let's continue with the third degree. Actually, in the third degree, we also cover, this one here. We also cover how we solve for the third degree price discrimination here, right? We just set MC equal MR in each market, alright? MC equal MR in each market, and that's how you, okay, that's, yeah, I ask you to calculate this yourself or not sure, but yeah, I show you how to calculate this example here as well. So this is when we can group consumer, right? We can group consumer. And everyone, we to implement, you see, to implement the third degree here, we have to be able to group the consumer or screen the consumer here. Screening is a process of for sorting consumer based on their characteristic. So everyone, there are few things about this characteristic. Some characteristic can be observable. Observable, for example, sex and age. You know that he is a man, he is a woman. Oh, sorry, she is a woman. Or you know about the age of the people, right? And also, if you have a student card, you know that this guy is a student. But some characteristic are unobservable, but everyone, but inferable. For example, PD and willingness to pay. I'm going to explain about how we can, let's say, infer the characteristic. I mean, how can we infer about the PD and willingness to pay? We use something like this, for example, time, everyone, time. We can use time to infer the willingness to pay. Let's say that Apple product, you know, Apple product, when we have a new iPad, someone is willing to pay a very high price for the new iPad. You know about the pre-order stuff, right? Yeah, let's write that down. iPad pre-order. So this guy here, someone who is willing to pay more for the pre-order product, means that they have more willingness to pay. Okay, they have more willingness to pay. Some consumer want to be the first who own the product. Seller can charge higher price when they first introduce because this guy are more willing to pay. Another thing that you can infer, everyone, another thing that you can use to infer the willingness to pay is the coupon or rebate. Coupon is, for example, you know, the discount coupon in a magazine, in the newspaper, or in a, yeah, magazine, I guess. Everyone imagine that you went to Tesco Lotus, you get the catalog, yeah, catalog. And you have some discount coupon here, right? In this case, everyone, for those who take time and spend effort to go through the Tesco Lotus magazine to get the coupon here, we can infer that they are price sensitive. Okay, so if you guys, yeah, before going to Lotus, let's say you find the coupon first. Oh, maybe think about GrabFood. I'm sure that we all use Grab during this time. And you know that Grab has a coupon weekly, right? Weekly coupon. If you guys choose to search for the GrabFood coupon, in that case, we can infer that you are price sensitive. So what we should do in that case, you should charge lower price, everyone. You know that when you are price sensitive, your demand will be like this. Your demand will be elastic, right? Your demand will be elastic. So if you lower the price for the elastic demand, you can get a larger revenue, right? You can see that the revenue here will be larger when you lower the price. So that's what we do. Another example is the rebates. Rebate is the partial refund, okay? And the example that I give you here is that when you buy the ink for the printer, ink cartridge, okay? ตลับหมึกนะครับตลับหมึก. You buy it for $20. But when you use, I mean, when it run out, when the ink run out, you can send back to the seller and get your money back everyone you get money back you get $2 money back so if we do I mean if we take if we spend our effort if we spend time and effort to process this rebate here it means that we are price sensitive it means that we have more elastic demand curve and for this reason we should use cheaper I mean the firm should charge cheaper price for those who process rebate or who use coupon okay that's the screening mechanism once again everyone these two things here can be used to infer the willingness to pay to infer the sensitivity I mean the price elasticity of demand all right in case you may not be able to observe the sex or the age I mean you can observe usually you can observe sex and age of people maybe online when you buy something online you don't know about the sex or you don't know about the age because you can lie right so in that case the firm can use this tool approach here now the next one that I want to talk about is the what we call the capacity constraint price discrimination with capacity constraint everyone the let me talk let me go back about the price discrimination here you see that you have two demand right you have two market you have two market we can group people into two market you know that you have one demand look like this and one demand look like this in this example everyone in this example we know that we should charge LMC equal MR in this market MC equal MR in this market But let's suppose everyone, let's suppose that, let's say that in this calculation, you see that we don't have any problem about the quantity that we supply. Okay, we assume here, everyone, we assume when we do this question that we can supply, we can produce as much as we want. All right, we can produce as much as we want. But sometime firm cannot do that but sometime firm cannot do that we say that sometime the production or the supply of the good is limited all right in that case we say that firm will have capacity constraint we have capacity constraint imagine about the seat of the airline company you have limited seat you have limited car for the car rental if you own a car rental okay so the difference between the normal sorry the third de- this is the case of normal third degree price discrimination right in this case you can supply you can produce as much as you want but when you have a price sorry when you have a capacity constraint you cannot do that your supply or the production of good is limited Now everyone, let's suppose that we can produce up to only this Q dash unit, okay? This is our limit. And we are going to supply, we are going to sell this unit into two market segment, into two group of consumer. So the question here asks you is that how should the firm allocate this limited supply into the two market to maximize your profit all right and the answer okay let's first say that Q1 will be the quantity supply to segment 1 Q2 will be the supply to segment 2 everyone to solve for this capacity constraint we use this condition First of all, Q dash here will be Q1 plus Q2. Okay, Q dash here must be equal to Q1 plus Q2, so that we don't exceed our capacity. Our production does not exceed our capacity. And the second condition, which is very important, MR Q1 equal MR Q2. Everyone, listen carefully. This means that the marginal revenue when you supply at the segment 1 I mean at the market 1 must be equal to the marginal revenue at the segment 2 why just think it clearly so okay let me draw something for you let's say that you have two market right you have two market and let's say that MR in this market is equal to 5 and MR in this market is equal to 3 everyone in that case if you have one apple of course you should supply to this market okay you should supply to this market the reason is simple because if MR you have to understand what does MR mean MR mean that when you sell one apple what you get is your total revenue will you get to, when you sell one more let me use quantity here to make it simple so when your quantity increased by one you sell one apple your total revenue increased by 5 that's what we mean by MR all right let me say again when you sell one more unit your revenue increased by 5 right your total revenue increased by 5 so in that case you will have you should if you have one apple here if you have only one apple here you should sell it here right not this one because if you sell in this one you get 5 your revenue increased by 5 instead of 3 but the difficult thing is that we have a Dawa sloping demand curve all right the difficult problem is that we have a Dawa sloping demand curve so there will be some trade off right so if you have many apple all right if you have many apple and then you sell into this market a lot suppose you sell into this market a lot at some point the price will be very low the price will be too low and your profit I mean your revenue will be too low so that's why you should kind of allocate some apple and then supply to this market and then if you do that what happened is that maybe in this market you will sell this and in this market you will sell this amount all right within your limited apple here so once again just to summarize there are two conditions first you must not the quantity you supply must not exceed your capacity And the second is that your MR between the two market must be the same, okay? If MR Q1 greater than MR Q2, it can increase revenue and hence profit by supplying more quantity in segment 1. That's what I just explained here. Now let's do this problem here pause and then read the question okay now I'm going to solve for the thing here this question here everyone we have two market segment Q1 equal to 200 minus 2 P1 and Q2 is equal to 250 minus P2 and lastly marginal cost MC is equal to 10 and your capacity is Q star equal to Q1 plus Q2 is equal to 150 here okay so everyone you see that there are two conditions the first condition is this one the second condition the most important condition is MR1 equal MR2 your marginal revenue between the two market must be the same okay everyone by the way let me quickly go to remind you this one when we solve for this you see that there's nothing about MC okay there is nothing about MC and that's because we assume here a little bit that we assume here that our MR is greater than MC we cannot supply all of the market alright we cannot supply all the market we have limited capacity but our thing is that our question is that how we can allocate that limited supply so that's why it's not about MC it's all about the money that you can make it's about revenue that you can make in each market so once again as I said you don't want to sell too much into one market if you sell too much your profit will fall your total revenue will fall your profit will fall so you have to allocate wisely now let's solve for this MR1 and MR2 once again everyone in the very beginning I told you before that you have to be careful when you looking at the demand curve everyone when you want to find the MR you have to find total revenue right total revenue and actually I'm going to use the property that the marginal revenue is twice as steep as the inverse demand curve but everyone this is not inverse demand right this is not inverse demand so what I have to do first is to convert this into inverse demand so here my inverse demand will be let's see P1 equal to 100 minus 102 Q1 and of course my MR everyone MR1 will equal to 100 minus Q1 and the second one here let me use the green sorry the second thing is that this is P2 right and then it's just this one minus Q2 and MR2 is equal to twice as steep so this is 2 Q2 yes everyone so we have this MR and MC as we need and the next thing let me crop this and then of course what we have to do next is to equate right MR1 equal MR2 and that's 100 minus Q1 equal to 250 minus 2 Q2 and then let's see 150 here and then yes and lastly everyone we know that our capacity is here right Q1 plus Q2 plus 150 so this is Q1 plus Q2 equal to 150 everyone you solve this and you are done right you solve this and you are done so let's see what I can do I can just plus the two equation together so sorry the space is limited so let me write it here okay I plus the two thing together I got 300 and then equal to 3 Q2 right 300 equal to 3 Q2 so your Q2 will equal to 100 and of course everyone your Q1 will be equal to 50 this is how you should supply how you should allocate limited output within the two across the two market so many people here I mean your friend last semester they did is it not sure if it this question or not but I remember that they made a mistake they don't use this equation here all right they don't use this equation here they just use MC equal MR and that's wrong everyone we don't care about MC right we don't actually use MC in this calculation and by the way the reason is simple you see that MR here MR equal to 100 something right minus Q1 right So there is some quantity, everyone. There is some quantity that MR is greater than MC, right? There are, listen carefully, okay? There are some quantity that MR is greater than MC. So in that case, you don't need to worry about that. But suppose, okay, suppose that your MR is equal to 5 minus Q1, something like this. In this case, I can say to you right now that you should not supply in this first market here. All right, you should not supply in this first market. But here in this question, you see my MR here in market one is there are some quantity here that is great. That make MR greater than MC. Also, everyone, look carefully. You see the demand here. You see the marginal revenue between these two market. You see that the number, between these two number, MR2 seem to be quite large compared to MR1. And that's why, everyone, that's why we supply more quantity into market two. Okay, we supply more quantity into market two because MR2, seem to look larger. Of course, if you sell too much, then it will be another story. But our capacity is quite small, so and your MR2 is quite large to 50 here, but 100 here for MR1. So right, so that's why. Let's explain why Q2 is greater than Q1 here. Okay, I will pause and then continue in our next clip.